Good afternoon. I'd like to welcome you to the Town of Deerfield Selectboard meeting conducted on March 25th, 2016 at 3:50 and at 8 Conway Street, south in the village of South Deerfield. That takes care of calling it to order. Do we have any public comments?
Public comments? No.
Having none, we'll move on to presentations. We have none. Comments for the Board of Selectmen? Dave, you have anything you'd like to?
I don't have anything.
Okay. We had a meeting last night, or Tuesday night, with the Finance Committee. The SCEMS budget was put out. They had some questions, and there will be feedback being given to them. We haven't had any meetings since our last ones dealing with the Tilton Library. There's one coming up on next week, I think Monday or Tuesday, for the building, this needs assessment subcommittee. What else do I have to do? And we've still looking for an outreach person for the South County Senior Center. That gives me your updates for that. Board of Health, in Carolyn's absence, I will tell you to wash your hands. The flu bug is still out there. And please patrol your yards and areas to dump as much water as you can, because this is the season for the mosquitoes to get a good grip on us. So empty and patrol your yards, empty water best, especially since it rained today and there's plenty of buckets full of water. So I don't think I have anything else on Board of Health at this point. We have to approve meeting minutes. We have February 5th, 10th, 11th, 24th, 26th, and March 9th before us at this point in time. David, do you have time to review any of them?
I reviewed the ones on the 5th, because that was a meeting that I attended, and I'm okay with that. So I move that we approve the meetings of February 5th.
I'll second that.
Okay.
Any other comments or questions?
No comments.
So the 5th, all in favor?
Aye.
Did you review any others?
I haven't reviewed any others.
That's fine. We'll put them on hold, and we'll go from there. We approved the 5th.
Okay.
David was there, so he wanted to go through that one.
I was here for the 26th as well, but I haven't gone through the minutes.
Do you want to take a minute to go through it, or do you want to just put them on hold?
If you've got to give me a minute, I can quickly peruse through it. I'll move that we approve the minutes of February 26th.
I'll second that. Any further comments?
Nope.
All in favor?
Aye.
I make that 2-0. Let's go ahead and move on. We'll pick these up later.
Okay.
Next item you might have is the Chief has requested a full-time appointment of Mr. Brent Griffin. He's a part-time, to move him to a full-time effective April 1st. He's well-known. He's done a pretty good job. He's been part-time for a while. Do I have a motion?
Yep, I move that we appoint Brent Griffin as a police officer and assistant officer for the town of Deerfield.
A second. Any further discussion or comments?
Brent brings a wealth of knowledge with his educational background and willingness to go through the academy on his own accord, and has been a part-time officer for the town of Deerfield for a year and a half, and the chief is highly recommending him.
Right. I think we also have to mention that he will be getting the education incentive stipend as part of this agreement. So I'd like to amend your motion to make sure that we include that as part of the discussion. Friendly moment.
I second that.
Very good. Anything further?
No.
Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And as I said, he's been very highly recommended by all the people that did. So is it the departments? Does the full board sign this or just the chair?
Each of you.
Yeah, there's no line, so you're confusing us.
Yeah.
Please sign above that one, above my name. All right. Polly, take care of yourself.
Thank you.
If you want to take the next couple of things out of order, I have a draft of the special town meeting warrant available for both of you to take a look at. This was prepared prior to a request that came in today from Carolyn to strike Article 8 from it. This warrant hasn't been opened yet. So my recommendation is take a moment, read through the various articles. You can move to open it, move to add the articles, and then move to close it.
I move that we open the warrant for the special town meeting being held on April 25th at 7 p.m. at the Frontier Regional School Auditorium.
Second that.
Most of these articles are very basic pieces of business that we need to try to get done before the end of the year. Article 8 was for the creation of a new bylaw, which after review by several different folks in town, the proponent of that bylaw has suggested that it not be included on this special town meeting warrant, but that it's going to be up for further consideration later on down the line. So
well,
that was Carolyn, basically.
Quite frankly, this article is ludicrous for any town that has any commercial business. So
exactly. Exactly. That was the concern. It was far too restrictive. We put too many restrictions on current business in town, as well as businesses that just drive through town. It would be impossible to manage and regulate. So I think, am I wrong? I am wrong. Does that warrant have the striking of one particular piece of bylaw in it?
Yeah.
Article 6.
Article 5 is stricken, currently
Correct.
Proposed.
That's certain. This is a recommendation from me. You can choose to include it or not. Article 5, which is Chapter 150 of the bylaws, I believe it is, basically mandates that all costs related to the sewage treatment system, the wastewater treatment system in town, be borne entirely by the users of that system.
Five is for the overtime
shift differential.
Okay.
And six has also got a stricken portion of it. So you're talking about six. Go ahead and continue to talk about that one you were talking about. We'll finish that one and go back to five.
Okay. Yes. Number six, Chapter 150, Article 2. This was put in place in 2002. It originally at town meeting was a resolution We're not sure how a resolution became a bylaw, because generally that does not happen. It was a resolution that was voted at town meeting, but it was included with the bylaws. And so people are pointing at it and saying that this is the reason why no improvements to the wastewater treatment system can be paid for through direct appropriation or through bonding that the town would have to pay for. A strict reading of this would also suggest that you couldn't use grant money or any outside funds, except they be fees paid by the sewer users to pay for upgrades.
So you're talking about Article 6?
Article 6, yes, I'm sorry.
And the thing about it is, as simple as it was to put this as a bylaw, it can be taken out of being a bylaw, and it's the same level of attention that anybody requesting appropriation of money for a sewer treatment plant would have to go through anyway. So it really doesn't, it's just housekeeping. It doesn't stop us from doing what we need to do. It's not an illegal act. It's basically putting it to the people's, the voters, to vote it. So
yep.
I have no problem with cleaning up the paper, the verbiage, and making it.
I don't either.
Okay.
That's fine.
So that was Article 6.
I have no problem with that.
Backing up to Article 5, thank you. This actually came up recently in relation to the ambulance service. There were some questions as to whether or not the folks who work second and third shift were getting paid a shift differential. And as it turned out, the folks who work second and third shift who were permanent full-time employees were, but the folks who work per diem were not. And there was, after consulting with both Zach Smith as well as Barb Hancock, we were confused as to what the original language of the article was trying to say. So what I did is try to wordsmith this article, the language. So instead of the onus being on whether the person was a regularly scheduled employee for a second or third shift, I instead put it on the department that says, if the department regularly schedules people to work second or third shift, then they must pay the differential. And I think that probably more clearly describes the intention. It does mean that a per diem who works only once a month, who picks up a third shift for the ambulance service, let's say, gets paid that shift differential. I also took the opportunity to recommend changes to the dollar amounts. These are in line with the current police collective bargaining agreement, actually.
So we're already paying that to the police department?
What's that?
We're already paying that to the police
Correct.
Department?
Yes.
Were we paying the dollar to the full-time ambulance people, or was it 40 cents?
It was the 40 cents and 65 cents for shift differential.
Forty-five
and 60 cents, yes.
So that's going to affect SCEM's budget?
It will a little bit. You figure it'll affect them about $16 a day, maybe $20 a day. So about $5,000 or $6,000 over the course of a year. And I don't think it applies to any other department.
When they did the study, I don't remember whether the ambulance service was on the study for wages.
You're asking whether or not other places do shift differentials, or?
Oh, I'm asking whether when the study that we had out of our office, did they cover EMS?
No, because we didn't have, in all the information that we had no comparative, we had nothing to compare it to. We're still working with Zach Smith to get names of other public operated ambulance services and to get information from them as to what they pay. So we don't have that yet. So.
Okay. Well, what was Zach's feeling on the raise of the money?
He was okay with it. He felt that that made sense. And it would give a little bit more incentive to get someone to work a second or a third shift. It wouldn't affect, and the understanding is it wouldn't affect someone who's on call for a second or a third shift. So the on-call rates, which are lower than the active rates, for the EMS at least, wouldn't have that shift differential.
Okay.
Any others?
Let me just really quickly look. The, in summation, Article 1 is there, but we may be able to pass on that because I don't think we've gone beyond our original appropriation for snow and ice, so we may not need to actually spend any more. That's terrific. It was a mild winter. Of course, it's not over yet. April's coming. The 57,899 is, of course, the administrative indirect costs. That's going to be transferred from the South County EMS retained earnings. Article three is the repayment of the so-called energy loan. We put it here because we would want to take it out of our current retained earnings for the town. That's also something that I think you need to make a clear decision on, because there's some question from the Finance Committee as to what this board wants to do. I'm actually recommending that it does get paid out of free cash.
It's a dollar amount?
It's $275,700. I have been figuring that into the budget calculations for about the past month.
The Finance Committee didn't give us an opinion as to whether we thought it was a good idea or a bad idea?
They actually, I think, are waiting to hear what you would like to do.
Let me see if I got this straight. The people that advise us on financial matters wants us to make a decision on repaying a loan before they tell us whether it's a good idea or not.
Well, no, broadly speaking, they advise town meeting, but... both Barb, she's right over there and she could probably talk to it, but I believe Barb, the town clerk, is in favor of paying it down instead of borrowing to pay it off, and I'm pretty sure that our town accountant also would concur with that, because it's such a small amount. Instead of, you know, impacting the levy or impacting our revenues for the next 5 years, and because we have such a large amount of free cash available to us, I think it makes sense to pay it down.
Okay. You heard it here first.
Oh.
After that, we have the...
Article 4, I would actually recommend that it get scratched, because after the work that the CIPC did... Wednesday night, it looks as though the recommendations related to the use of the municipal building fund are going to be included in the regular capital request that's on annual town meeting warrant. So we're still doing the things, we're just putting them all into the same place as the other capital requests. So it makes more sense to just leave those there. So Article 4 will get stricken.
Okay.
We already talked about 5, we talked about 6. Article 7 is there at the request of the Planning Board. They will be holding a public hearing, I believe, on April 4 to receive comment on changing the zoning to allow self-storage warehousing in the C1, C2, and industrial zones. And Article 8 we've talked about striking already. I think there was an Article 9. Way at the end.
Article 9.
Yep. Special legislation to extend the powers.
Right.
Chapter 121C.
This article is on this special town meeting warrant at the request of the folks who run DDIC. This is the last step in the process to allow them to expand to include commercial use in the industrial park. We have a draft motion. It's wordy and complicated, but basically it's the town saying yes to the legislature, to the state, please make this happen. It does have to happen through a special act of legislature.
Okay.
And it has to start with town meeting. And that's it. That's the special town meeting warrant.
Okay.
So my understanding is we've opened it, and the changes that we've recommended at this point is to eliminate... to strike
Article 4.
4, 8, and everything else is good. Is that your understanding?
Article 8.
I
Leave number one there. We will probably just ask to bypass it.
We can bypass it.
Let's leave it there in case.
Article 3, could we include the dollar amount?
No. Absolutely. $275,700.
Yep.
Yes, absolutely.
It's going to have to be in the motion anyways.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. But I just want to make sure it was in the motion.
Yeah. When it said if it's not in the motion, it can't be a valid item because you can't just pay an arbitrary number.
Yeah.
So.
Strike Article 4, strike Article 8. Article 3 will have the dollar amount amended. As long as you're okay with what Article 5 and Article 6 suggest.
Yeah, I don't have a problem with those. As long as Zach doesn't. You know, it
should
will affect
his budget. Should we put something in there to any town employees not subject to the bargaining units? Or should that not necessary?
The original language didn't include it, and I think that Mass General Law says that if you have a collective bargaining agreement, it supersedes, if there's any conflict between a CBA and the town's bylaws, the CBA takes precedence.
Okay.
And I actually believe that's language in the CBA as well, just to confirm.
Okay.
So.
Yep.
As long as we're covered.
Yep.
If Article 1 is required to be in there, we should put a dollar value on it also. When's this go to
needed.
Print?
If it's needed. Well, that would be in the motion.
Yeah. Right. Just to make sure that.
Yeah.
And I'm only saying these things to make sure we do it, not to have criticism or.
Not at all.
Or
fair enough. Yep. Okay.
All right.
Make a motion that we close the warrant for the special town meeting.
As amended. Second that. Any further discussion?
No.
All in favor?
Aye.
2-0. What was the other one you want to take out of order?
This, I think, is a copy of the regular town meeting warrant. I've been able to work closely with town's moderator, Peter James, and with our counsel, Lisa Mead. The articles, I believe, are in there in their final form. If you allow me a moment, though, I'll pull up my copy. There was one article in here that I wanted to recommend removing. If I can pull it up. Not that. Oh, where did it go? Raise and appropriate. Recommendations of the CPA. Raise and appropriate. Perhaps I stand corrected. You were okay. Article 15 is the funding article for Smith Vocational. student tuition. Just a side note, that will be changed to one student, as the three students that were in attendance at Smith Folk graduated, and or will be graduating, and we will only have potentially only one student attending this coming year. That's a really nice impact on our budget.
Do you think it'd be smart to leave it at two? There's a sum of money that's attached to that, right?
For the Smith Vocational?
Yeah.
There will be a sum of money attached to the motion. I don't have the final numbers quite yet because I'm not sure about the transportation number. I do have the tuition number, but there's also some negotiation because apparently the student who's applied lives half-time here and half-time, I think, in South Hadley. And so the question is whether or not the town of South Hadley is going to be picking up half the bill.
At times we've been hit with someone moving into town or somebody leaving Franklin Tech to go to Smith Vocational.
Oh,
and
I see.
If we, the money's going to come back to free cash if we don't spend it. It's
Certainly.
Not like it goes to the school systems. It's just going to come back to us. If we don't, then we have to appropriate more money in. So it's a catch-22. It doesn't matter one way or the other. It's just...
Sure. Yep.
Dave, have you got an opinion on that?
No, it's
we'll leave it at one then.
Yeah, I think it's...
Very good.
Second one wants it. Can we say we don't have the funds for it and you can't go?
We can't do that. We tried that once.
Oh, okay.
The suggestion, I don't know if it's in your copy, is Article 25. I've already got lines drawn through it in anticipation of this. My understanding is that because of the nature of the intermunicipal agreement, it may not need town meeting approval to make changes to it. I've consulted with Lisa Mead. She's of the opinion that the intermunicipal agreements are exempt from requiring from needing town meeting approval.
We're going to have plenty of town meetings to discuss what's going on with it, so we'll get the pleasure. The Board of Selectmen will get the pleasure of the town as to whether or not they approve or disapprove. So I have no problem with it being there.
Didn't in one of her comments she say excluding the changing location?
It did. I've requested clarification on that. I don't have that back yet. I don't know if that meant changing of the location of the physical, activities of the enterprise, or if that meant changing of the location outside of the three
yeah.
towns. Changes like adding another town would require three town meeting approval. Beyond that, I'm not
okay.
really sure. To some extent, I feel as though that the change of location would be connected to the who would be the fiscal agent, for example. For example, if Greenfield wanted to buy in and Greenfield wanted to become the fiscal agent, that would require town meeting approval for both of those reasons.
All right.
But I don't know. I'm still waiting for clarification. It can stay in the warrant. You can choose to pass it over if
right.
we don't need to do it,
right.
But it's there if we need it.
Well, if we get Lisa's opinion on that, mm-hmm. that it's not needed, I'd leave it off the warrant myself.
Okay,
it's fine with me.
Okay.
The thing is, if it's on the warrant, no matter what Lisa says, I would not recommend that we pass it over. We have the discussion, go through the process, and
okay.
inform everybody at that point in time that this is a nicety. We did it as a common courtesy because it's on the document, and go through and explain what's going on and let people
okay.
Take the opportunity to make sure that they see what, that it's transparent. It's not somebody's trying to do something. So,
following that, Articles 26 and 27 deal with the Lake Street Development Partners. Solar project happening up on the top of River Road.
I talked with the assessors. They've got a better number for us now.
They do have some numbers. I have some questions about the long-term impact of doing things the way they're recommending. That being said, they've given us a schedule of payments and a number that they're happy with. My intention was to forward that to the folks at Lake Street for review and see if we're anywhere near close to the mark. If it's something that they can agree with, then we can be on our way to the races. So there's that.
But the payment in lieu of taxes has to be basically what the assessed value is. There can't be really much negotiation on that unless they file an abatement with the Board of Assessors, right?
Correct. My understanding, though, is that there are different means of assessing the value of solar projects or of, you know, these type of energy generation facilities, that you can either assess the actual value of the equipment, either as installed or retail value. You can try to do an assessed value of the resale value, which is near on impossible. There's no case, you know, there's nothing to point to, you know, use as examples. Many towns have used, however, a revenue value, where basically they point at the amount of DC generation capability that the array can pull, and then from that they assign a value to it. Most of the time it's anywhere from $10,000 to $17,000 per kilowatt of capacity, which means that an array like this would be anywhere from 8 or 9 or 10 or whatever, 10 to 17 times 6, like $9 million, let's say, and then you tax based on that. Most of the tax agreements, structure tax agreements that I've seen, are basically level payments over 20 years.
Yep.
The difference is the Board of Assessors is looking to do a structured agreement that front loads the payments. Mm-hmm. So the first 3, 4, 5 years, it's a higher payment, and then the remainder is much lower. The meaning, or the intention, is to capture new growth in the first year. I'm concerned with what that will do to the tax rate in later years.
People will get used to that money and expect it every year and not have it to available.
Yeah, that's, right.
That's kind of scary.
My suggestion would be, we can do that. That's fantastic. That's great. And there's no law which says we have to do, the law says that the money has to go into the general fund, general appropriation. But the town could also commit itself to taking that amount of money in line with the schedule and put it into stabilization or capital stabilization.
That would be basically, it'd be a good way to build up a stabilization fund.
Yep.
Essentially to ignore the fact that it's new tax revenue.
Right. Yep.
Well,
it is, but it's
in and out, and you pass it through.
Right.
It's basically, we link it together. If we're going to go that way, that's the only way I can see doing it, because we get clobbered. Hey, can we just do a summary of those things that are not the housekeeping things?
Sure.
We'll start with, we got the SCEMS budget, that's housekeeping. 12 is the capital improvements, that's housekeeping. 13 is for... community preservation issues that they're going to put forward us.
Yep. 14 is the Frontier Regional Council of Governments appropriation.
Yep.
Number 15 is Smith Vocational School.
Has that changed much, 14 changed?
I think it's a little higher this year than it was last year, but not by much. It's still in the 40s, I believe, high 40s.
We talked about 15. 16 is...
It's $10,000 for a sick leave and vacation account. That's done every year.
That's standard budget.
Yep. The reserve fund is $80,000. That's standard every year. Let's see. The triennial recertification, that's
standard.
$20,500, I think, this
that's
year.
It's a little higher. It went from 17 to 20.
That's per de rigueur. The OPEB, Article 19. I've put in the budget, I think I put in $50,000.
That was our recommendation.
Yeah. So,
and again, so people understand, that's a line item that covers us from future ballooning of the baby boomers in the retirement fund.
Yep.
So that we're putting money aside in case our retirements don't cover what we think it's supposed to cover.
Yep.
And that's a projection that the state is doing. We've enacted the legislative to be able to do it. Last year and this year, we're just going to put some seed money in because we really don't know what it means.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
And if that's funded, that also help improve our bond ratings, right?
Correct.
It does. It does. Article 20 is requested by Carolyn. That's to appropriate a sum of money for legal expenses related to Montague's intervention at the DPU. Actually, Conway just voted to do this, I think, this past week. Oh, no, I'm sorry. It's Ashfield that voted to do this just this past week. And the amount of money I think that is requested is either $10,000 or $11,000. I think it's $10,000. So there's that.
How much did Ashfield?
They're not asking for anything. This is
so how much did Ashfield
appropriate? Oh, $5,000.
$5,000?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Article 21 is to set aside some money for mosquito abatement programs, and I do have some information on that if anybody cares to take a look at it. And I think the request was for $11,000 for that. The town was going to be involved in a mosquito abatement district or a mosquito controlled district, but apparently there's a service that basically every town in the district is going with instead because the price is far less than the district turned out to be. The district turned out to be very, very expensive. Looking really closely, Deerfield would have been $15,700 on a $300,000 budget, which apparently would have only done some basic testing and monitoring. On a $500,000 budget, Deerfield's assessment would have been $26,000, which would have done some abatement work. This company actually looks like would do the abatement work and would do it for about $11,000. So that's Carolyn's recommendation.
I think there's would start to be trickling some federal funds towards this because of the Zika virus. It's hit Connecticut already, so.
My understanding is actually that the state of Massachusetts is looking to reduce the funding for the agency through the Department of Public Health that would actually help to control mosquitoes. Their budget's actually been cut, so. Article 22 is as it has been written. However, Carolyn has recommended changing the salary of the Board of Selectmen. She's recommended changes of $6,500 for the chair and $5,000 for the other two members. So I put those changes into here, and I put them into the selectmen's budget. It doesn't throw us into the red or anything like that, but it's a significant change, so that's probably something you're going to want to talk about. Or not.
Waiting for him to digest it.
Yep.
Well, you know, to get new blood into the system and everything, you know, and, you know, the unfortunate part about it, really people don't understand how much work is involved in being on the Board of Selectmen until they're actually doing it. It's really, it's, you know, it's a 20 to 30 hour a week a lot of times.
It can be, particularly this time of the year.
So, and then as we get into the budget seasons, there's a lot more. Then those who are involved with the other subcommittees and stuff, or Board of Oversights, it's, there's a lot of time. So I would recommend an increase. I don't know if I'd make that much of a jump.
The thing about it is we can leave it in there, and if you settle on something, you know, lesser, we can always go down. We can't go up on the town meeting floor. So I'm ambiguous. I don't, you know, either way is good with me. I agree it's a healthy jump. I would rather make the statement we're going to go up, you know, a couple thousand dollars, and then next the following year a couple thousand dollars, so that it's trends up rather than just doing it in one big belt. The recommended column, who's got the recommended column?
That recommendation is from the Finance Committee. They had already taken this up and voted certain amounts. They did not, they have not seen Carolyn's change yet.
Okay. So that will be resubmitted to the,
Finance? It will be submitted as an addendum to the budget.
Okay. I recommend we let it stand at this point. And,
yeah, I don't have a real problem.
We'll see what the board, what the our financial agents recommend to us.
Okay.
Okay. Article 23 is boilerplate. It just confirms that all expenditures are contingent to funding by the cherry sheet and any other state funding that may apply.
Why is that so far up in the budget?
Basically because all the articles prior to it have something to do with appropriation, spending money.
But none afterwards?
I don't believe there's any afterwards.
Because we usually, that article's usually the last one we do. So just if that's, if Peter and them are fine with it, that's good.
Yep. Article 24 is a placeholder. The expectation is that there's going to be a number of parcels of land that the town is going to be able to dispose of. I'm working with Richard Kalaszewski on going through the list of town-owned land to see what pieces can be sold and what would make the most sense. As we pull up a list, we will be taking a look at them. We will be circulating the information about those pieces of land to other town departments to make sure that no one else foresees a valid use for it. And we'll certainly be bringing that list back to you prior to town meeting. But the expectation is that once town meeting gives the approval to dispose of it, the board can choose to dispose of it as you see fit. If that is transferring to a different municipal department or transferring to another municipality, that's one of the things you can do. So that article basically allows us the freedom to put some of those pieces of land in place.
Good.
We have at least three that I know that we'll be looking at selling in the coming year, and that's three that the board already has the authorization to sell. It's up off of Stillwater, goes between Stillwater and Sand Gully Road.
Yeah.
We're in the middle of doing an A&R because that piece of land, the bulk of it, constitutes the brush dump and the back end of the landfill. So we're cutting off the northernmost section and creating two separate building lots that are both valid building lots that the town can then sell while maintaining the rest of the the dump.
Have we appointed an auctioneer for the other parcels?
We have not. We are going just through a request for proposals.
Okay.
Yeah.
For auctioneer or?
For the land itself.
Okay.
And we're promoting and advertising that as best as we can. The three or four pieces of land that are currently up for sale, we've had a number of different people come in and take out the paperwork to prepare a bid for it. So. Because we've got the assessments on the paperwork, hopefully the bids will be where they need to be. So.
Okay.
Pretty good.
Let's see. Article 25, we've already talked about. Article 26 and 27, we've talked about. Article 28 is the citizen's petition submitted. Essentially as instructions to officers. It's instructing the moderator to appoint a municipal government study committee. There it is.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I believe that is it, other than instructions to officers and to the election. And that's your town warrant. I'm going to be, I hope, publishing this at the same time as the special town meeting warrant, so it'll be a couple of weeks before town meeting, on or about April 8th, 9th, 10th, or so.
A
couple of weeks.
On the, read the article for the...
What?
Instruction to the officers.
So on the next to last page.
Yep.
Yes, the last page.
To to see if the town will vote any instruction to its officers, boards, committees, commissioners, or pass any vote or votes in relation thereto.
Yeah, it's the next paragraph.
The meeting will then adjourn to meet in the polling places at the meeting room in the town offices on Monday, the second day of May, 2016, next at 10 o'clock in the forenoon, then and there to act on the following article. Yep.
We don't put a end at a close of business time for the
at least last year that wasn't there.
So it's 10 o'clock until forever?
Good point. I'll find out if it makes sense to put
if there's
in
something in the bylaw that says it's only 6 hours after we open or something like that, that's fine, but I've never seen it without a start and a stop time.
If you weren't here at 10 to vote, forget it. You lost.
10 o'clock yeah. only. They only let the people here at 10 o'clock to
forget
vote.
Forget it. We're closing the door.
10:01, we're closed. We're done. We got enough votes.
Yep. I like that. That sounds good to me. Elections, Chicago.
Talk about
style.
A simple majority.
Right. I will check on the language, and I'll work with Barb to make sure that that meets muster.
Okay. Thank you.
So. I move that we close the annual warrant.
It's actually already been closed.
It's closed. We're just doing a review.
A review?
Yep.
Okay.
I just want to make sure that you understood everything was
yep.
there. And
I thought we closed it before, but I wasn't sure.
Yeah,
we were making some changes.
Well, we left it to so that if we need to put something else in, somebody came to us with something
yep.
significant. So it would,
okay.
We had enough placeholders to land the B-52, but so we reviewed that special town meeting warrant. We're into the budget.
Yeah, there it is. The most recent addition to the budget packet is the, do you have that, David?
This?
The budget, there it is, okay, yep. The most recent addition to it is the South County EMS budget, which was modified, amended, and approved by the Board of Oversight a week ago yesterday. That budget is coming in less than it was last year because of the use of retained earnings, because of increased expectations for fees for service, and because of a few bits and pieces of savings, reductions in certain line items. For
yep.
example, fuel, which was far higher than we think it will need to be. Even this year, the fuel costs are only about a quarter to a third of what was budgeted for, so we believe that cutting it to about half of the appropriation from last year will be just fine.
Okay.
Going from 20,000 to 12,000. There were a few other lines that Zach went through and was able to make some changes on. Bottom line is it's coming in at about $70,000 less than last year. Plus the plan is to buy an ambulance, which I think is terrific. I'll be replacing the oldest ambulance and bringing the service up to
mm-hmm.
fairly new equipment, so that's terrific.
So basically, the Finance Committee went through and just didn't recommend any of the changes for the benefits on each of the departments. Is that why did they do that? That was just for clarification what each department's actually costing us, right?
Correct. Yes. Those sheets are in there only for your information.
Yeah.
They're not included in the final tally.
Okay.
They're not included in calculations. It's just there is it. And they're not even accurate, I will fully admit. They're estimates.
Yeah.
But they're there to basically allow you to see that portion of the cost related to each department.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
And there are a number of things that at the time of printing that the Finance Committee had not looked at, and therefore there were no recommendations on a certain numbers of those things.
Mm-hmm.
So
the door's shut.
She wanted to get, she wanted to pay taxes.
Oh, okay, there we are, sorry. I want to point out a couple of line items that are directly related to our corner of the world. I have reflected the change in salaries for the Board of Selectmen in that budget. Mm-hmm. That represents the jump of about $9,000. The Selectmen staff salaries, there's a huge jump there. We're going up by $35. In the Selectmen staff salaries, I've added a part-time, unbenefited clerk that would be available to the Planning Board and to this board to basically manage paperwork, manage agendas, and manage minutes. That is something that I haven't talked to the board about or gotten approval for yet, and I'm certainly willing to take direction on that. That being said, it still fits inside the budget, and there's a definite need. That position would enable us to more fully staff the Planning Board. I think that in the longer run, that position should probably become a function of the Planning Board and should be included in that budget. But being an elected board, that mm-hmm. does make sense to allow them to have that administrative staff.
So you're only anticipating maybe 10, 15 hours a week?
10 to 15 hours a week. I believe I've budgeted it for more than that, for I think 18, but I don't anticipate it being more than 10 to 15 a week.
Okay.
And I'm willing to reduce the amount to say 12 hours a week if that makes sense. I can certainly do that. If I go from the 18 hour a week request down to 12, then the staff salaries budget will drop by about $5,000.
So in cap, are we gonna go through this in some order, or do you want us to just hunt and peck on things we've got questions about?
I'm happy to do it however you'd like.
It's up to you.
We normally do a line by line, you know, just flip through it and see if anything jumps out at us, but
we can do that.
It looks like the capital improvement rejected the tractor.
Actually, they didn't. They approved it, but I was nervous about our bottom line. I talked to Kevin and asked if he would be able to get by this summer with the tractor that he's got, with the assumption that in the fall we would come back at a special town meeting and use the FY16 free cash to buy the tractor at that point. He said that he felt that the current tractor would barely get by, but it would get by through the summer.
What if we don't have the free cash?
What's that?
What if we don't have the free cash?
Well, if we don't, yeah, if we don't have $72,000 of free cash in the fall, then we're really in trouble.
Yeah, but if we, you know, we still try to keep a reserve of some money. You know, if we're down under $300,000, buying a tractor is not, we're taking away all our seed money to do anything the following year.
Right.
It's not, you know, if we're promising that to him, then let's make sure we say that out loud in the meetings and you know that basically. But I would like to set a target that says that if dollars are below a certain amount, we're going to have to, he can go rent a piece of equipment for what he needs, or we'll wait until the next fiscal year to to put it in there, because I don't want to leave us short of revenue at that point in time.
I have no problem putting it in this year as well. Again, it was approved by the CIPC. They understood the need. They said, yes, definitely, it makes sense. Right now, with all the numbers being equal, and again, this is without accountants' final scrutiny, although Brenda's been involved with this all along, right now we're at $265,000 of free cash after all is said and done. That does include putting $100,000 into stabilization, $50,000 into OPEB, and using about $102,000 of free cash for capital requests. But it felt to me
the 265 is what we're going to use?
265 is what is left.
Left.
That's out of the $1.4 million of free cash.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm personally okay with running over the fiscal year boundary with that little free cash. And I'm pretty confident what we're going to get certified in August or September will be another very large number, a high six-figure number. That being said, it's just a prediction. So if the sentiment is that we want to get this tractor right now in FY17, then we can certainly put it back in the number, put it back in the budget.
Well, I'd like to have it on the table for the Finance Committee to contemplate. I'd like to make sure that we can always take it out.
Sure.
It's impossible to put it back in.
Yep.
So if the Finance Committee is good with the logic that we're putting in front of them, then fine. If they have an issue with it, then we can go from there. So.
Yep.
But it was approved by the capital improvement.
CIPC did approve it. Yes.
Yep. So I want to. I think it deserves our comments, our questions, or our discussions during our joint meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll, at that time, we'll make a decision whether we include it as part of the motion or not.
Okay. I've run through the revenue numbers with Brenda. She's very comfortable with the numbers that we have. The estimates for fees and local receipts were dead to rights on. She's very comfortable with those numbers. And the expectations for the other revenue accounts are also solid. She's comfortable with using those accounts. There will be some slight changes to this budget because we are using a fund that consists of donated monies to fund the school resource officer. In order to properly use that fund, we have to break out all of the costs related to that person, and that will have to be a special article in and of itself, which now I'm thinking about it, maybe that's going to need to go somewhere into the warrant. I'm not sure about that yet, though.
Run that by me one more time.
There is a special revenue fund that was authorized at last town meeting.
Right.
To accept gifts is that the public safety fund. In order to use monies for staffing out of that fund legally, we have to include all of the costs related to that staff person, including benefits. And it has to be broken out, it has to be completely separate from other broader appropriations. At least that's my understanding.
Is it because of the way we have it defined as a person's taking that position?
No, it has to do with just the fact that we created a special fund to accept donations for public safety.
But if we put the position there, mm-hmm. and it was filled by any officer, we wouldn't be able to tell what the costs were because the broad width of what we pay an officer is not mm-hmm. manageable.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that if we just say that it's a funded by a person instead of the person, then the money can shift over to the department to be used as to fill the need.
I will need to consult with Brenda as
check
to how
on
we
that
need
and
to
see
do that.
Would you check?
Yeah.
I mean, I feel strongly enough that the resource officer position is a necessity. But I feel that we have a talented individual there that will do more than just resource officer stuff.
Absolutely.
And if we pigeonhole him into the thought process, then we can't put anybody else in there. I think we've tied our hands unnecessarily. So if we put it to the department, then it's just the department's discretion to make sure that someone's in that role. And I think that, you know, if we're going to get into the school's not supporting the resource officer, which to me is totally ludicrous, then we can look at the 2 months that the school is not in service, not in functional, and maybe cut back the cost of that person,
mm-hmm.
that line item to be the 180 days that they work versus the 280 days that everybody else works.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think that I'm, again, very disappointed in not having the school want to be fully engaged all year round. But it is what it is. So if we can make it so that it's actually the department uses that person for 2 months during the summer on something else that's special need, special functional, then you know, I really would rather have him working on bullying and everything else that occurs in the schools. I'd rather have him full-time doing that. But if we're not getting the support, then the town should get the time that the school is not in place, not in service. Mm-hmm. And then it won't hurt as much. We're still going to pay, but it won't hurt as much. So I think that we need to have further discussions on that.
Okay. Fair enough.
Have you put your personnel issues in front of the personnel board? Your requests?
No,
not
but I will
not
be
issues.
On, but I will be on April 4.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think it's a wonderful thing you're doing. So let's make sure it gets on in front
yep,
of the board.
Absolutely. And I'm really enjoying engaging with the folks on the personnel board. I found them to be a real valuable source of information. They've been really reasonable and terrific to talk with and to bounce ideas off of. There's a lot of experience and talent there. So plus one to them. Thank you for their, publicly. Thank you to the personnel board for their help. The really quickly hitting the budgets in the general government. I think if you've got the summary of the general government budgets all told, you're seeing a really crazy high percentage increase of 15%, or it adds up to about 120,000 round numbers. That's deserving of some explanation. One of the biggest increases is the fact that we are taking in the public access television revenues. Whereas before, that was simply money that came into a special account, was expended from that special account, and it never really hit the budget. New DOR rules state that we actually have to account for it, and it has to be appropriated by town meeting. So it looks like a really, really high increase in our general government line. It really isn't, because it's matched up with an increase in revenue on the other side. Right. It's just an adjustment upward. In terms of the other increases, there's a bit of an increase in the treasurer's expense due to the number of elections that will be happening. Really quickly hitting all the other numbers. Our legal expense, we're over that budget. I'm going to need to do a transfer request for the end of this year just to cover what we've spent so far. And so I'm making a request for a significant increase to our legal expense. It's actually an increase over last year, but it's a decrease from FY15, which was a decrease from FY14. We've sort of been dropping the request for legal over the past several years, and so as a result, we've gotten caught short. So,
no, it's been by design. We've kind of limit legal, and I think we've got a good legal team, and we're just going to balance out wherever it needs to go. So, I don't, in the past, we've always been really, really short.
Right.
And before your time.
Sure.
Before 2015, 2012, we've been really, really short, where we put in $5,000, $10,000 and then have something prop up. And
sure.
And this is just trying to find some, you know, mm-hmm. some medium.
Yep, fair enough.
We get
negotiations coming up, too.
We do have the CBA negotiations coming up for the police union. So that's going to hit that will hit this year. I'm hoping
sure.
really to have that resolved before the end of the fiscal year.
Okay.
So I think our contracts are in pretty good shape with them.
Yeah.
I think basically it's not going to require a lot of work.
Well,
so hopefully we'll
yep.
have
hopefully
another
we'll
good
get through it
negotiations. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep. The public safety also shows an increase of about $95,000. Only about half of that is the cost related to the additional position, the school resource officer. The remainder is coming from our inspections salaries budget. But again, with the inspections, that's offset by an increase in revenue on the other side. This is just rolling in our electrical, plumbing, and gas inspectors onto the budget. They were never there before. And rolling in the revenue from those permits and applications into our revenue side, which was also never there before. It was always been done through the revolving fund. This is keeping everything as clear and transparent as possible and making sure that folks know how much the inspectors cost and how much is being expended. So. Education has an increase of about $253,000, which is actually the increases from Frontier and from Deerfield, I think, are about 310 all told. They're offset by significant reductions. First of all, we're not making a capital payment on Frontier anymore. That's paid. And we're seeing about $29,000 in reduction from Franklin Tech assessment and our Frontier transportation bill. So there's that. Our highway department is going up by about 4.5%. It's a little higher than we kind of would like.
Have the schools finalized their budgets?
They have, yes. I was able to be at the Frontier Regional public presentation of their budget, and having been there, I've got a pretty good a renewed appreciation for just how much they have to do to keep their budget in balance. There were a lot of expenses that hit that they weren't expecting, and they're using a great deal of their excess and deficiency money to offset those bills. That being said, there's still, I think, room to talk about this coming year, and hopefully there's going to be some opportunities for consolidation savings, joint efforts to do various common tasks and therefore save money in doing so. And that's going to be coming down. I'll have a little more in my report later on. Let's see, we're seeing about under a 2.5% increase for our culture and rec. We're seeing just about a 3.5% increase on our human services. The majority of that is for our Board of Health expense salaries. We're basically adding a few extra hours to the health inspector, or the health agent, sorry. And again, rolling in money for an assistant health inspector or a per diem health inspector. So there's that.
Now, if the medical marijuana comes to fruition, there's going to be quite a bit of time from the health inspector there.
Correct. And we should be able to offset some of those expenses through the host agreement.
Okay.
Yep. As I mentioned, culture and rec is up less than 2%, less than 2.5%, which is good. We're seeing a reduction in our overall debt service, which is great. And I want to thank Barb Hancock for working through the predictions for the DES roof. It looks as though the bond for the roof probably won't hit until FY18. So all we're worrying about is the short-term borrowing. That's an expense of about $15,000, and that's easy to deal with. That's pretty much all we're going to see in FY17 for that. And our benefits line.
That could be offset by the donations from the private schools, right?
We're actually going to hold the donations for the private schools until. I mean, we could use it for that, yes. But the expectation is that we'll hold it for reducing the overall bonding amount.
Okay.
So there's that. And our benefits line item, because we've got a little bit more accurate numbers in terms of the offsets, the costs that are parsed out to the EMS or to the senior center or to the wastewater treatment, we're actually seeing a reduction in our benefits bottom line, which is terrific.
Uh-huh.
It's not really a reduction in the cost of insurance. Insurance did go up a little bit, but as it turns out, it turns into a reduction. So that's that. We do have, or we've had at least one meeting, only because it's next on the line, we've had one meeting in regard to sewer fees and ways to assess for the cost of sewer. We should have a couple of options to look at in the next couple of weeks for the board to consider.
Beautiful.
And that's going to be, might be a little bit of a shock to some folks. The one strong recommendation that we're getting, and that I think that you have already considered, is to basically issue a sewer bill to the town for the use of the sewer with every town building. That includes the elementary school. We'd issue a bill to Frontier Regional, particularly if the sewer users are expected to pay for the cost of capital upgrades.
Oh, we already sent one to Frontier.
Nope, they have not been charged a sewer bill. We're working on developing previous year's sewer bills and sending them out without expectation of payment, and it's likely that we'll give them a sewer bill for FY17 without expectation of payment. But we want them to understand what they should expect. We don't have an established rate.
No, but in the same token, if we build it out and didn't expect it to get it back and put it into the sewer reserves because that's what they're covering for us.
Sure.
Then it's just coming out of the same pockets. It doesn't matter who pays for it. It's the fact that the townspeople see that this service is doing more than they're getting paid for doing.
Mm-hmm.
So mm-hmm. I wouldn't have a problem with submitting the bill, and then if they're not paid on their budgets, just take it out of the general fund and put it into the sewer reserves, because it's no right. No money's changing hands in any of this. It's just
no, not at all. No.
So, but I think it would be a great idea for that next.
Technically, money is changing hands. Remember, especially with Frontier, Deerfield pays about half the bill. Two or three other towns pay the rest. Mm-hmm. And so, if we issue them a sewer bill for $10. Deerfield's only paying $5 of that, and the other $5 is paid from its money from elsewhere, just like the South County EMS administrative overheads. It's a $57,000 bill, but $28 of that is being paid for by two other towns.
Valid point. Yeah.
So, and the reason I said we don't expect payment from the school, I only meant to say that we want to give them a year or two of back bills so they understand what the costs are. We want to give them a bill for FY17, and we don't expect them to pay that because they didn't budget for it.
Right.
It'd be unfair to ask for that. When it comes to FY18, this is now a bill you must pay.
I thoroughly understood that. All I'm saying is that right now we're looking at the money to move forward with the sewers.
Very much so.
And I would, even if we just took 50% of the bill, because it's our share, mm-hmm. and put it into monies that show up on the ledger for the sewer, mm-hmm. then at least it would be showing that there are a lot more values to that commodity than people are seeing on a day-to-day basis.
Mm-hmm.
And it will also give us the seed money to start looking at how we're going to fix things.
Right.
Can we go back to the assessor's expense and assessor's salaries?
Certainly.
Usually the Board of Selectmen and the assessors kind of track expenditures-wise for amount of salaries.
Sure.
The assessor's expenses have been dropping regularly. If we got them to agree to drop it down to some aspect, we could move that money into their salaries and show a salary increase for them also. Their expenses are much higher than the Board of Selectmen's expenses.
They are.
So what I'm saying is if we can look at it and say, hey, they've done a phenomenal job of not expending all the money that's in the expenditure. If that's what they anticipate seeing over the future, we could move that money and have actually a zero impact on the budget,
mm-hmm.
and give them a pay increase also.
Okay.
So that might be something you want to look into and just see if we can do. Because if we're going to recommend a raise for the Board of Selectmen, they probably should consider what that does to them, since they track pretty close. I don't know what other assessors make monetarily wise, in comparative, it's always been just compared to the Board of Selectmen.
Sure. I don't know if I have numbers on that. I will look into that.
If you would just, you know, drill down into it and see if there's something that can be negotiated with them to make sure that we're not leaving them in the dust completely.
Okay, sounds good.
Can you find out how much the two, three districts actually pay them as well?
How much the three districts pay?
The assessors.
For doing the assessment for them.
Oh, I see. Okay, I'll find out.
You got the water, South Deerfield Water, South Deerfield Fire, and the Deerfield Water and Fire.
It's one. So district. There's four districts.
Okay. And they pay for services through the assessor's office. Okay.
Yes.
I wasn't aware of that. All right.
And again, just to make it even, you know, just so we're all, everything's above board and clean.
Okay. Will do. There is a meeting on Tuesday of next week of the Tri-Town Beach Committee. I do not believe they have enough members to constitute a quorum. If they don't have a quorum, they can't review and make a budget request. This presents a significant concern.
How many does Deerfield have?
Deerfield, in theory, has three appointments to that committee. Right now, I'm not sure if we have, I think there's one person that is actively appointed to it, that's currently on it. I'm not sure if that person is in communication with the committee or has even attended a meeting. I need to contact that person and make sure they're aware of it. There we are.
I'm missing what you're saying. We have three people appointed?
We have three potential appointments. Only one person is appointed currently from Deerfield. Only two people are appointed currently from Whately.
Do we have anybody in that has requested to be on?
Not at this point. And we've consistently been advertising that there's openings on that committee.
So. If we only have one seat available at this point in time, I think what we should do is recommend that the Board of Selectmen be appointed to the vacancy seats so that we can have a quorum to make the budget and make it work. Okay. And then as people become available, then it comes forward. So I would make a motion that since you're not going to be around to make the, when's the meeting?
I'm sorry?
When's the meeting for them?
I believe it's Tuesday. I was going to look up the exact time. I think it's 6. Quickly checking. And I don't have it here.
It's okay.
I think it's at 6. As a matter of fact, I'm almost positive it's 6.
I'd like to make the motion that we appoint Carolyn and myself to the Tri-Town Beach Committee. I don't know if you can do it temporarily or whatever, but...
You can do it for a term to end June 30th.
Fine. To complete out the term to June 30th. So that they can make out a budget and stay afloat if they want to.
I'll second that.
Any further discussion? You're not volunteering, are you? Oh, no, you don't have, I can take you off the floor. If you want to be on Tri-Town Beach, just let me know. Raise your hand, and one of us will gladly give up a seat till June.
See about that.
That was a motion.
Got a motion, seconded.
Oh, you did get it the second?
Yeah.
Did you vote it?
No,
we're waiting to see if we have somebody to
stop us from our insanity, and nobody's stepping up. All those, no further discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. I'm sure Carolyn will love the opportunity to serve on another committee.
I nominate Carolyn for chair. Since she's not here. And that's not possible, so that was all in jest, guys. Nobody's looking to take over any... All right. Please check and make sure there's nothing in our bylaws that prevents us from doing that.
I will. Let you know. Absolutely. Yeah. Just really quickly looking at everything else. As I mentioned, the energy loan is in the, included in this budget, so that's that $275,700. It's a big bite, but paying it off instead of paying 2 or 3% interest over the next 5 years or 10 years or whatever seems to make the most sense.
What's driving our cost for the legal fees to be up to $30,000?
Significant use of it. There was extensive use of our attorneys related to a couple of personnel issues earlier in the year. There were a few legal issues that we did get help with in relation to an appeal of a ZBA action earlier in the year. We've also used them extensively related to the purchase and sale of the Oxford property.
Okay.
Yeah. I am truly hoping that as we come into this next year, I'm going to be paying very close attention to who needs legal services for what, and do we really absolutely need to do that? I'm going to try to keep that budget as low as possible, but
I've been in past administrations. I've asked for us to look at the other towns and see if we can find common ground for what they've got legal opinions for already. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if they've already answered the question, why ask it again?
Sure.
Only if we don't like the answer is the time that we should be spending money on it. So, mm-hmm. You know, it's the more we can standardize a lot of this stuff, the cheaper it's going to be for the long run. So,
as we're going through and doing things like RFPs and IFBs and public procurement of various kinds, I'm definitely looking into seeing what other towns have done. And if I can copy their RFP and just change the dates, change the names, I do it. Right. If I can copy their contracts and do the same thing, I do that. I still put them out to legal counsel, but if I'm giving them a document that's already gone through legal review, the likelihood is that there's going to be less that they're going to have to worry about, less that has to be changed, and it saves a lot of time and money. So.
Have you ever had two lawyers in the same room agree on anything?
No.
Oh, okay. Well, just...
I wouldn't presume to be so optimistic, but. And as I mentioned, I think earlier, the Capital Improvements Committee under the capital items, they did approve or recommend most all of the capital improvements to the Tilton Library, the South County Senior Center, and the town offices that were there, with the exception of the flooring at the South County Senior Center. They approved replacing the flooring in the lounge area, but not in the kitchen area or in the, they approved the flooring in the bingo hall,
right,
but not in the lounge dining area or in the kitchen area.
Right.
I think it might actually be worthy of reconsideration. I think perhaps this board might be willing to still make the request, even with a negative recommendation from the CIPC, because we're only talking about $700, and it's coming from the municipal building fund anyways.
The board met the other night, and it was on the observations of the chair that they felt it wasn't necessary. I think I'd like to have Dick go over. he's got a better critical eye for what's really needed and what's not needed, and see if he can give us an opinion.
Mm-hmm.
That way we've got something that we're hanging our hat on,
mm-hmm.
rather than somebody's casual observations.
Sure. Might also suggest there might be two or three good folks on the finance committee who would enjoy taking a look at that as well, because they'll be looking at these capital requests as well.
Yeah, I mean, it's however you want to work it, but I think that if we get an opinion that's in our house,
mm-hmm.
to look at whether we're doing it or not, and it's the premature or whatever, it'd be really good.
Okay.
Okay?
I'll make that recommendation.
I appreciate that.
Richard, sure.
On the capital request, the Ford F-250 with a plow that was withdrawn, how much was that?
That was $42,000. That was withdrawn by the superintendent because he felt that we were hitting the sewer reserve account a little too hard. He's concerned that we're going to be draining that down significantly, pulling the 130 out of there for the Headworks Design Services. So there's that.
So he wasn't looking to try to defer it to a special town meeting in the fall?
No, he's just setting it aside.
Okay.
If the money is there in the sewer reserves in the spring, he'll probably put the request up again. That's my read on it, at least. So
he going to have enough equipment to keep the dry bridge clean because he can't put his regular trucks on it?
Yes, I believe so. I know he's got, is currently...
No, he's not giving up the... It was a replacement of a vehicle, wasn't an addition, so I'm sure that he's not going to abandon the vehicle. Or
okay. The one that's at the sewage treatment plant right now is a two-wheel drive Ford F-150, I think. I don't think it's being used for plowing.
I don't think so.
Yeah.
That's what I said. I think that's why you can get away with it.
Right.
It's cheap to fix, and... He's going to improve his fleet by moving to the next one, but I think you're right.
Yep, but he does have at least one F-250 or F-350 currently in top-notch condition for the highway, so
okay.
Should be okay there. That's where we're at. I think that's it. I will continue to run this entire budget past our town accountant to make sure that I haven't made any mistakes. She will be thoroughly checking my work, checking my math, to make sure I haven't carried over a zero or a decimal point or something where I shouldn't have. But up to this point, we're pretty solid.
Can we get the numbers for the street lights? The expended amount for 16?
Yep, we can. I believe the last time I checked, we were on target to hit about 33 or 34,000 this year.
Well, I mean, we're still a significant amount. $33,000 is still a significant amount. If we go to LEDs, for what we're doing right now, we could realize a bigger savings if we yep. put a plan in to actually start changing some of these to LED and controlled. And they're pretty simple to control now. I mean, you can put them in and basically control them from the wastewater treatment facility, time them, do whatever you want to do with them, bring them to your own. So, I mean, we didn't do anything last year because we had just gone through with Eversource or Western Mass Electric Company to change out a lot of stuff
mm-hmm.
for us.
Mm-hmm.
It got us down to where we are, and realizing that going from almost $50,000 to $33,000 with the cost of electricity going up was still a great thing. But the electricity is so high now that it would be smarter for us to do that.
Yeah.
And the other thing is to see if we could get it in maybe some of our solar credits.
Okay.
See if we can take, because that's a different line item. I don't think that's paid through the COG, is it?
Wait, which is?
I don't believe the streetlights bill goes through the...
Through HCOG, you mean?
Yeah.
I believe it's part of the same bill, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. As is the new electric service on the common. That's all coming under the HCOG contract.
Can we get a total of what we use for electricity now at some point over the year?
We should be able to, yeah.
Yeah. I think we really need to start focusing on some of the savings we can realize from those.
That Siemens contract, most of that savings was at the elementary school, right?
Correct.
A great deal of it was, yes. That also paid for the shutting off of certain streetlights. It paid for upgrades at the Tilton Library. It paid for a study to look at removal of windows on the north side of this building. But the majority of it, yes, was over at the schools, at the elementary school.
So that's the group that had the very highly trained engineer that thought the roof was only being held up by the windows?
Here, yes. Yes. I'm not actually personally not sure what holds the roof up.
Well, it definitely isn't the windows.
No, it definitely isn't the windows. Okay. Honestly, I think it's, to be honest, I think it's held up by the weight of this roof over us.
Yeah.
Yeah. That this they're just hanging here. Out cantilever style.
Cantilever.
Yeah. This roof here is holding that roof up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That and the 2x6s, or 2x3s that hold the window in place.
Yeah, right. The 2x3s that hold the window are holding up the whole roof, sure.
I hope he squirreled his name away for future reference.
Say what again?
I hope he squirreled his name away for future references.
Yes, he did.
Did we get any accountings from Tri-Town Beach?
We do have their accountings from FY15, and the expenditures from FY15 were about 60% of the appropriation level. The accounting so far for FY16 shows about 40% of what they had appropriated was expended. We don't have any accounting for any of the fees that were collected at the Tri-Town Beach.
Okay.
Or the Tri-Town Swim for, I don't know if there are fees charged for lessons or anything like that.
Yeah.
So that is something, however, that Lynn Sibley and Mark Prohinsky are aware of, and they're looking into it to see if there can be some, tracking of what was brought in, how many users were down at the Tri-Town Beach, and so on and so forth.
Pay $16,000 for a $44,000 salary in benefits.
We did?
Yeah.
In what budget are you looking at?
It's not important.
I would say rec.
It's not important.
Oh, yes.
Just in general, looking at the real facts of how much it costs to have somebody here enrolled full time and. Very good. Anything else?
You. There's going to be very slight bits and tweaking as the budget goes forward. What I am hoping to do is to allow the requests that are presented in that booklet be survive the Finance Committee recommendations and be forwarded to town meeting as they are. One of the things I've been trying to reinforce with CIPC and Finance Committee, and everybody actually is, and I'll give kudos to both Dylan Carpita and John Pereski, because I think they both understand this as well, that both of those boards advise town meeting and offer recommendations. But this board, the executive of the town, should, and by right, I think, has the authority to make a recommendation and to make a request. The budget, I truly believe, is the expression of your interests and your desires as you move forward, and it shows what you see as important in the town. And I think that should survive to town meeting intact, with a recommendation right next to it. Finance Committee certainly should be advising town meeting to say, we think this is too high, we think this is too much money, we think we can't afford this, whatever it happens to be. But I'm striving to do my best to make sure your request comes through there as well.
So. Okay.
Tagging onto the end of the budget, this is actually something that would be coming up later anyways. We did receive a phone call from a gentleman named Joe Markarian. He's working through the Franklin COG, and he is available to us over the next year or so to help do some long-range planning related to finances, financial policies, investment policies, capital improvement policies, and so on and so forth. And my suggestion, I mentioned it to Mark yesterday, I think, after the CIPC, or Wednesday after the CIPC meeting, is that we form a sort of an intensive study group that could start meeting sometime after 1 July to really start looking at a long-range plan, that it would consist of members from all of the key boards, the assessors, the planning, CIPC, finance, and the Board of Selectmen, along with getting input from the town accountant and the town treasurer, to move forward on creating some financial policies that can then drive our budgeting process moving forward into the next fiscal year. So I really hope to have a more fleshed out proposal coming to the board in the next month or so.
Okay.
But that's coming up. Do we submit a budget that has a zero at the bottom? Or do we submit a budget that still has a positive number for free cash?
You mean a line item budget?
Yeah, the budget that you just looked at, it's got somewhere around $200,000 sitting at the bottom of the budget as unspent. Expected revenue that is not being spent. Is that de rigueur? Is that expected or?
No, because
that's free cash that we haven't used.
That's free cash that we haven't used. And if we don't appropriate it for the FY17 year, it'll become decertified as of 1 July,
right.
Go into limbo,
right.
Until it's recertified again after the recapture.
Our policy is to have between $400,000 and $700,000 in that number.
Okay.
So, and that's why I said what I did, as to whether or not the Finance Committee is going to agree with the paying off of the bill, because that drops us below the $400,000 we kind of target as a low end.
Mm-hmm.
And if they agree with it and disagree with the fact that we're dropping below $400,000, we have to find the $150,000 or whatever it is to get it back up above $400,000. We have an issue.
Yeah, I don't know where that would come from. So yeah.
So. From my point of view, it's going to be a hearty discussion.
Mm-hmm.
I have no problems with this, because you feel strongly that we're going to be have some free cash to replenish. So
I will feel more comfortable after 1st April and after we get 3/4 underneath the belt of the town, and we'll have a stronger picture as to what our fiscal year 16 is going to shake out to be.
Right.
I could be way off base, and I really hope I'm not.
I think that just in the items that I picked out in the budget, you know, it gets us above the 400,000.
Yep.
Just because of what didn't happen this year with snow and ice and everything else. So I think we have a good budget to present. I don't think I got to worry too much about the throes of it, where somebody would come up with the money. My recommendation, if somebody's forcing the issue, is to just not pay the and go out for a bond and let the finance committee justify.
Fair enough.
They're the ones who deal with the financial recommendations to the town, and if they're not going to recommend us to pay down debt and whatever, they're the ones we trust to give us that insight.
Sure.
To me, they're either or.
Yep.
Are acceptable. I have no.
There is the other option also, because that the payoff of that loan is an article on special town meeting. There's the option to use a different funding source, specifically stabilization. We have something like $1.6 million in stabilization, and if we pay it off through that, then it doesn't. Then we are allowed to, or we'll be able to carry over $500,000 or $600,000 in free cash.
Well, the fact that we have stabilization to rely on is another good thing. Mm-hmm. I would rather not take it out of stabilization to pay for a bill.
Sure.
It's not its intent. And if we get in trouble, then we go after stabilization. I would rather pay it out of free cash and not add the extra burden onto taxpayers at this point in time.
Okay. What else do you have on your agenda? Let's see what's next.
We have approve and sign the contract for the lease of the town-owned land, the cell tower lease.
We do have that ready to sign. This has gone back and forth between Eversource and our legal counsel, and Sarah Bellino has said that it is good to go. She agrees with the lease agreement, the terms of it. And I know that Eversource is very eager to get their work started up there. They're going to be doing some improvements to the site. So if you've already granted the award, mm-hmm. This is just a pro forma signature.
Yep.
And I think, yep, there are places for both of you to sign.
Very good. Street sweeps policy, you want to move in the discussion on that while we're signing these?
I'm good with that.
We have to vote this? Yes.
No, it's just for signing.
Just for signing.
That's all it needs to be.
He does say approve, but it's just signing the contract.
Yep. The complete streets policy, I think you have, you've had a copy of the draft policy for some time.
Mm-hmm.
I did do a revision to the document that removes some of the shoulds,
mm-hmm.
and instead put in softer terms like may or shall endeavor to basically create a direction that the town can go in related to all of the various implementations in the policy related to making streets appropriate for bicycles and pedestrians and so on and so forth, but not requiring the town specifically to do anything that isn't required in MGL.
Very good.
And that was at the request.
Mark? The only question I have on this is 5C. Is the not to exceed 30 miles per hour of posted speed. If it's not posted, I believe in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, 35 miles an hour.
Number
in residential.
5C or
5E, I'm sorry.
5E, there we go.
I forgot to lift up my glasses so I could see.
Well, again, I would point out the not to exceed 30 miles per hour or the posting speed. Okay.
You can check with Johnny on that, but it's...
Yep, yep.
I think it's... if it's not posted in a residential, it's 35 in the Commonwealth, under 9017, so...
Oh, you're saying it should just be 35?
If unposted residential is 35.
Okay, fair enough. We can make that change.
But I just want to confirm it with John. That's what, you know.
Okay.
It's been a while since I wrote out a citation.
So. Fair enough.
But that's what it was.
And make a recommendation we approve the streets policy statement with the required modification of miles per hour.
Yep.
As reference to David's comments.
I'll second that.
Anything further?
Yep.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
There is a request that I've received from Mike Phillips. This is to your next agenda item. I want to try to do this so I'm not talking about names. I don't want to embarrass or point anybody out, but Mike Phillips has received a request from a town resident, a longtime town resident, who owns a plot of at the West Deerfield Cemetery. It was bought by her family some time back. Her husband is already buried there. But due to the placement of the, what do they call it, big cement thing they put in the ground, the vault, in that plot, what they were hoping, where they would have one more plot in this lot of land at the cemetery, is not quite enough room for a vault to be placed. It would extend beyond the boundaries of their plot at the cemetery. Mike and Kevin have both taken a look up there. They've done measuring of the various plots that exist. There is room immediately adjacent so that if a vault goes in on this plot and extends beyond its lines, that it would not interfere with any other grave or any other plot at the cemetery. It wouldn't cost the town an extra plot of land. Because this particular family is in dire straits financially, because it is just the one, the matriarch of the family, who's in fairly poor health, and because she just has a wish to be buried next to her husband, in proper format, Mike Phillips was requesting your approval to allow a one-time variance, if you will, to allow for this person to use land beyond their plot. He's recommending it. It doesn't extend beyond the boundaries of, or won't impact any other plots up at the cemetery.
I move that we approve Mike's recommendation.
Second.
I don't see a problem.
We've drawn up an agreement which basically identifies what is permitted, what's being permitted. And I also, upon conclusion of this, it will state very clearly that this plot is now closed completely, and that this is done only because it's only taking up a very small portion of land. So, thin sliver, a foot or so, I guess.
Okay.
Great. Mike will be very happy to hear that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And is that it? Nope, that's not it. Nope. There are actually two contracts that you could take a look at to sign. Perhaps I just have the one here. I apologize. My recommendation is that, and actually DOR is mandating that the town go out for an RFP for PEG access television services. Because of my history with the local access, I can't run the procurement. So I reached out to Wendy Foxman, who offered to do the public procurement for PEG access. And she gave us a very, very good price on that. She's willing to do it for $50 an hour for no more than 20 hours that it will take. And the cost of that contract can come out of our PEG access retained funds. it will allow us also to do the PEG access procurement for the other three towns that are served in our area. We have to do this because we never have. In order to comply with the DOR's regulations, we have to open this up, allow public competition, and while it's extremely unlikely that anyone else will take it up as an opportunity to get into the public access TV business, it will sort of clear the books.
Okay.
It clears the title, so to speak. So with your permission, we can get that going. And I'm sorry, I thought I had it right here. And I guess I don't. Boy, I feel embarrassed. I don't.
Make a motion to approve the contract with and sign it at our leisure.
I'll second that.
Anything further?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
The only other contract, and this is not on your agenda, oh, it is down under other business, actually, is a shared equipment contract that Kevin has requested authorization on. This is for the purchase of a bucket truck. In this case, it's the towns of Deerfield, Whately, and Sunderland that would be buying this together. Each of the three towns would put in the same amount of money to purchase the piece of equipment. Sunderland would be the owner of title and would be the principal garage to house the equipment, but each of the three towns would have equal access to it. The towns ultimately would share expenses. Each town would put in about $500 a year into an expense account to cover basic maintenance and repairs. Any town that damaged the truck would be responsible solely for the repairs to repair that damage. And at the end of the life of the truck, the equipment, it would be sold, and the proceeds from the sale would be equally dispersed to the three towns.
That in our budget?
It's definitely in the budget. Kevin is expecting to be able to cover it entirely inside of the highway budget. He believes that he can use a little bit of the money he has this year to make the purchase, and the cost from there on is just going to be the cost of fuel and the $500 a year for the maintenance payment. So it will likely come out of his tree budget because that's where this will likely be used the most.
So he doesn't have to do an RFP or anything for buying this? Or
nope, because it is an intermunicipal contract, you don't have to. Okay. And because Sunderland is the purchaser, if there is does have to be an RFP, they're doing it, not us. Doesn't have to be approved by town meeting or anything. Okay. There it is.
Sounds good to me. I move that we sign the shared equipment contract for the bucket truck.
Second. Any further discussion?
No. Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Let's see. I'm just going down towards other business, and this is that contract. We can sign it when the meeting's over, I suppose, or you can grab it now. It's up to you. Oh, there you go. The Finance Committee has requested a joint meeting with the Board of Selectmen. I think the date that has been bandied about is April 6, Wednesday. It will be 1 week after the South County EMS public session. That will be 1 week before the pre-town meeting information session. And it would probably be the last opportunity really to make any significant changes, if need be, to the budget or to the town warrant. I believe that Dylan is also looking to explore opportunities for future collaboration between the Finance Committee and the Board of Selectmen. So I leave that in your hands, whatever you'd like to do with it.
April 6 is our normal meeting, so I gladly accommodate that. I know Carolyn would,
Okay.
It's not a precursor, but she's trying to limit the number of nights she has to go out. She don't like driving at night.
Okay.
So I have no problem with it.
Okay. I will extend that date out to Dylan and see what he says. We've received a request from the Lions Club through Peter James. They have their car show every year. That's coming up in the next month or so. And in the past, the Board of Selectmen has granted a or put a moratorium on tag sales on the date of the auto show. I believe it is, and I've got the, it's going to be on July 16 from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. That's a Saturday with a rain date of the Sunday following. And they've requested that a moratorium be placed on tag sales, at least on the Elm Street extension and the Elm Circle area, because that's where the show is happening. The chief of police has weighed in and recommends the same, to make sure that traffic is kept to a minimum as best as possible. Further, the Lions Club has requested that the police department basically go around and make sure people aren't having tag sales. Apparently last year they did it anyways without permits. So.
And I mean, the only one that really affects them is the ones right on Elm Street, because people stop right in the middle of the road to do the tag sales, and there's a couple households that go pile right there because that's, you know, great advertisement and great, they got traffic flying by them. So
sure,
I have no problem with the moratorium on the Elm Street area.
Make a motion for the moratorium with tag sales on Elm Street and Elm Circle and the day of the Lions Club car show.
I'll second that. Any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
We also need the, we usually waive fees.
You've already done that, I think, about a month and a half back when we got the request in February, I think.
Sure. Very good.
It was waived already.
Gotcha.
One of the last things I've got a few comments afterwards, but one of the last things for action I've got is a request for comments received from the ZBA. This is in regard to a shared driveway that the ZBA actually is entertaining a request from a resident of 17 Keats Road for the use of a shared driveway. The driveway is currently shared, but it's a non-conforming use or a non-conforming situation, and so a special permit is needed to have that shared driveway be continued. I have a request for comments here if you care to look at it, and it has
the map. Is that the one Dick was investigating, that they want the shared one paved?
I did not know about it being paved. My understanding is that it's, because it's a shared driveway, because it's a non-conforming condition, and because the neighbor or the resident is trying to expand, rebuild his house or expand his house, and because the neighbor who actually owns the driveway does not want to continue that use, and because the person has plenty of frontage where they could cut a new driveway in on their own, that's why the permit to get the building, the building permit was not granted because of that. And so the person's gone to the ZBA to get a building permit in spite of this, to get a variance for it.
So if I understand this correctly, it's so that the person can get a building permit to work on a house because it's it occupies a shared driveway, which the two proponents are against still sharing it.
That's my understanding. Yes.
It's not about having it shared. It already is. And it's trying to determine whether or not that person has to get his own driveway or not.
Correct. Correct. Just in casual conversation with the building inspector, the reason the building permit was not granted is because the person, because a dedicated driveway is possible and could and should be done. And the person just doesn't want to do it because it would mean,
it's expense.
Well, I don't know about the motives, but
yeah, it's an expense or whatever. So.
Yep. So I have that. If you care to include comments, there's maps of the property in question as well as the public notice regarding it. So.
Okay.
I'm going to quickly run down and look at my notes to see if there's anything specific that you need to be worried about. I had a meeting yesterday with the school superintendent. We discussed a number of different things. including a coalition of rural school districts everywhere from the Berkshire school districts, north, south, south central, and central, I guess, as well as Mohawk, Gateway, Frontier, Pioneer, and school districts as far east as almost heading to Worcester, all the way out to Mahar Regional, I guess. They all participated in the meeting, and they are going to be working on a white paper or position statement related to school transportation, related to transportation reimbursement, funding models for public schools, and so on and so forth. She said it's very likely that also schools out on the Cape will also become a part of this coalition. Basically, every school other than the very rural, urban school districts are going to be taking part in this and trying to get their message heard at the state level. There was very preliminary discussion about creating permanent HVAC and electrical positions at the school district. Because apparently the amount of money that is being spent to service HVAC and electrical equipment is upwards of the neighborhood of $200,000 a year. And for that kind of money, you can hire people straight out. So they're looking at that as a possibility for not FY17, but FY18. And they wanted to talk with us about the possibility of making it a shared department. So I think at least it's worth talking about. We went over the Smith.
$200,000 on HVAC.
Yeah, it's a lot of money.
It's a lot of repairs.
Yeah.
Well, I think they have, by the looks of the filters that they have stored upstairs, they do a lot of regular maintenance, and it's taking down of all the air exchange filters and stuff like that. So I would assume that that's a, we're paying a premium for that fee.
The janitorial staff can't change filters?
No, not if you saw their systems.
One would think, though, changing a filter should be easy.
When you get into that size units, you don't, I mean, my company contracts out changing of all the filters because they're all usually up in the ceiling. Mm-hmm. And if the ceiling is plenum space, you got to have plenum rated filters. You have to have it depends on how great our architects left us with not having access to get to these spaces, and it, you know.
Okay.
So I think it's a great idea that they're looking into it, and
yeah,
you know, and I think that once they get away from that, then there are some things that janitorial stuff can take care of. Mm-hmm. And should take care of.
My own personal thought is that if the towns are serious about it, it would actually make more sense to form a maintenance district, if you will.
Yep.
To create a separate entity, a multi-town district that would have two, maybe, possibly three people. But those two or three people would be available for every town building, every school building, the regional school, and be able to maintain all of these buildings. And I think that would make a lot of sense and probably be the most cost effective for everyone.
Yep.
But more discussion on that is forthcoming. I mentioned earlier that Smith Vocational for next year, it looks like Deerfield will pay one, maybe less than one student tuition. I'll get final numbers as soon as possible. The Mill Village Road culvert was temporarily repaired, and that repair seems to be holding. Kevin's very happy with how it went, but we are going to be looking at a permanent replacement coming up that will involve a precast three-side culvert, and that's going to be $150,000, maybe $200,000 worth of repair work. We are hoping for the governor's small bridge replacement program to go into effect as of 1 July, that will be a competitive grant program by which we might be able to apply for a grant to pay for the entire project, which would be ideal. And as I mentioned earlier, the snow and ice budget is...
There's a culvert there talking about that would hopefully alleviate some of the flooding on 5 and 10.
Correct. And actually, we found, or Kevin found, after getting into the repair, that the culvert that was there, that existed, he thought it was simply blocked. It was actually partially collapsed. And that's part of why there was... Not the entire reason. The five beaver dams upstream also had a lot to do with it. But it wasn't helping that the culvert was partially collapsed. So the repair's in place, and it should be good for at least the year. But we're hoping to do a full repair soon. And as I mentioned, the snow and ice budget is not expected to exceed the $83,000 that it was appropriated. Cross your fingers. Hope we don't get snow. in the administration side of things, we're looking at an upgrade to the town's website. We're working with virtual town halls and schools to upgrade and improve the look of the website and improve the functionality of it. If anybody tries to log onto the website with one of these things, they'll realize it's very, very hard to read. The upgrade would actually allow for a cross-platform website that makes it easier to access information through a smartphone or a tablet. And that's going to improve people's ability to get information. It'll also improve our ability to get information out to folks as well. We've already talked about the PEG Access RFP, and I'm looking at estimates for upgrading our equipment in this room, our TV equipment. We have the money in the account to do so, and I'd really like to move forward with that because we've got equipment that's failing rapidly. Actually making recording in the conference room or the kitchen pretty much impossible due to issues with sound, so there's that. And finally, we're looking at making use of services from a company called King Information Systems. They're going to be coming in, and for a few hundred dollars, they're going to be doing an assessment of our document storage systems, and they're going to provide some recommendations. This is the first step in creating a better filing system, a better means of access. The public records law updates are coming down quickly from the state, and that's going to require a great deal more organization and responsiveness on our part. And in order to do that, we need to make sure everything is where we want it to be. Other than that, on Monday night, here is a presentation that's being done. For anybody who's been in town for a few decades, it's called When the Road Came Through. It's a slideshow and discussion on the building of Route 91. And it'll include information about the bypass of Route 5 and 10. And should be very interesting for folks who are longtime residents of Deerfield. That's a program being done by Tilton Library, and it's going to be in the main hall here at Town Hall.
Fantastic.
On March 30th, we're having the property sale site tour in the morning, 10 to 12, where we're going to be walking folks around to the various pieces of property that are for sale. And on April 6th, I will be away in the afternoon going to a Complete Streets workshop in Sturbridge. That's, again, another piece of that process by which hopefully we can apply for and receive some grant money from the state to improve our downtown streets.
Very good.
Past that, the only thing I would request is a very brief executive session to discuss, very brief, 2 minutes, to discuss a couple things related to purchase and sale of real estate.
I don't think we can.
What's that?
It's not on our
and if it's not on the agenda, you can't go into executive session?
That's my understanding.
Fair enough. We'll do it another time. Do it at the next meeting.
Very good.
And I finally found the contract for the PEG Access, which can be signed. But that's all I have. Thank you.
Okay.
Any other comments?
No comments.
Very good. Thank you for coming out. I'm going to take a motion to adjourn.
I'll second that.
We don't have anything to sign, so with the exception of the PEG Access.
Yep. Nope.
So, I'd second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Closed that.